Thank you, sir, for your concise and informative lecture. Now, I request Professor Faizan Mustafa Sahab, Vice Chancellor Nalsar University of Law, to deliver his lecture on the topic Right to Education Act, Challenge and Said Perspective.
We live in a very strange situation. You have an act, yet we do not know what is free education. The act does not define it. And from the tuition fee or what, nobody knows. And we live in a strange country where the lawmakers, and that may justify my presence here, because that is not the your vice chancellor's cup of tea, that Indian law till date has no clarity about who is a child. We are talking of, you know, Right to Education Act, and children from 6 to 14 are to be given compulsory free education, and I told you they don't know what is the meaning of free education. But we even do not know what is the meaning of a word called child. So if you look at our classical law called Tazirat-e-Hind, which you must have heard of in any number of Indian movies, Indian Penal Code, they give us two versions. One is that one is a child if he is below 7 years of age, and if he commits any crime, it will not be considered as a crime. So there is an absolute immunity to a child below 7 years of age. And then a child between 7 to 12, he may be held liable if he has attained sufficient maturity. And take it from me that when in 1860 this law was made, a child below 12, there was some doubt whether he attained maturity or not, but all children of our age, jaise hum kehte hain hamare daur ke bacche buzurg hote hain, then so they have much more maturity than any one of us. If you look at the United Nations Convention, because of which you got this law, it says any child below the age of 18 is a child. Any person below the age of 18 years is a child. If you look at your Juvenile Justice Act, which especially deals with, you know, child delinquents, they say any person below the age of 14 years. If you look at the Indian Majority Act, it says any person below the age of 18 years. If you look at some other laws, rape laws, age of consent, is it below 16, 18, 15? You have various versions in different laws. If you come to personal laws, recently you had a judgment from one of the high court that a child who has attained even 12 years of age under the Muslim law, exercising her right under option at puberty, the child may nullify the marriage and the age is 12 because it is uncertain. And if you come to your Right to Education Act, for it, the definition of child is 16 to 40. So the country is not even unanimous about who is a child in my country. Now, as to the education, which is the theme on which I have been asked to speak, we have very, very depressing scenario. Only 53% of all habitations in India have a primary school. On an average, an upper primary school in a country which is now boasting to be by 2020 a developed world, and our best wishes are with them and we want India to see there. On an average, an upper primary school is 3 kilometers away in 22% of habitations in India. More than 50% of the girls in the country do not enroll in schools. When working outside the family, children in India put in on an average of 24 hours of labor per week, and this is at the cost of education. 60 million children are thought to be child laborers, and that's why the case which I am making is anyone who is not a school should be considered a child laborer. more than 35 million children in the age group of 6 to 14 are out of school. Only 45.8% girls complete education in rural areas as compared to 66.3% boys. And in urban areas, 66.3% girls complete education as opposed to 80.3% boys. And then this is depressing. 39% of schools in India do not have any provision of drinking water. And this is worst. 89% of schools in India do not have a toilet. Now, in this scenario, when Qari Sahib started with the Tilawat-e-Kalam-e-Pak and Iqra, I am reminded of, you know, good old days in Aligarh. Coming to, you know, Manu somewhat gives me new energy because I miss the Aligarh, typical Aligarh environment where I have spent more than 25 years of my life or so. What has really gone wrong, even though this is not my topic, but in the context in which I am talking and because of the audience to whom I am addressing. Our share in the education is still far more depressing. We are doing worse than even the scheduled caste and scheduled tribes, and if there was any doubt about our share in education, you now have a Sachar committee report and several other committee reports. But this evening, I want to make two propositions before I come back to my topic. It is in the context of Muslims. One, that the mere fact that the very first revelation commanded Prophet to read, the translation which was done, read in the name of God, means that Islam is a religion of education. And is it not a fact that till almost 11th, 12th century, which is a period of rise of Islam, the same period in the European history is known as Dark Ages? Don't think sun was not rising in Europe for those 400, 500 years. It was. It is considered to be a period of dark ages on the continent of Europe because they were not able to compete with the Arabs in terms of education, in terms of philosophy, in terms of sciences. And from 11th century onwards, we are continuously in dark ages, and Europeans reinvented themselves through Renaissance and Reformation, and I don't know when we will have a Muslim Renaissance. Sir Sayyid did try it. Maybe Manu can play some role in it. The dean asked me to speak about my impressions of Manu. That brings me to my second area to which I want to speak. But before I go back, the very first line of your act says that it's a language, it's a university which wants to promote Urdu as a language. Well, there is no doubt about it that it is not the language of Muslims alone. Nowhere in the world Muslims speak Urdu except in some parts of India and some part of Pakistan. Of course, it is not a language of Pakistan as well. Yet, there is a very specific article in our constitution which has a relevance to my talk this evening. This is called Article 29. It's a very interesting expression. It says all sections of Indian citizens having a distinct language, script or culture of its own shall have the right to conserve the same. All sections of Indian citizens. And therefore, it is my constitutional right to conserve not only the language of Urdu, but also the script. And it is towards that pious and cherished goal that this university was established, but languages are not developed in the universities. Languages are developed in the schools and in the other educational institutions. And that's why the next article, Article 30, is of crucial importance. I don't have occasion to talk on Article 30, but that I will reserve for some other day. If you really want to conserve the language or a script or culture, you have to allow minorities to establish and administer their educational institutions, because you have to create an atmosphere which is conducive to the conservation and preservation of their language and culture. And that is why I say that there was very detailed discussion in the Constituent Assembly that let there be a fundamental right to get a primary education in the mother tongue. And there was a consensus on this. In fact, the Subcommittee on Fundamental Rights and the Minority Rights recommended it. Just towards the end, somehow, some people said, what are you going to state in the Constitution? It is too obvious to be stated. And as a result, you know, it is not there in the Constitution. And since it is not there in the Constitution, we have seen the plight of Urdu over the decades. Maybe the trend can be reversed under the able leadership of the Vice Chancellor at MANUU, but I am not sure whether higher education can play that role. But certainly the primary education and the school education has a lot to do with that. And that brings me straight away to your topic, the challenges to right to education. And my very humble submission is straight away is this, that there was a reference to that visionary founder of in dialogue that a nation is great only in proportion to its advancement of education. How we treat education, I have given you some depressing facts. In terms of money we spend, the government of India spends only about 0.76% of GDP on education, which is less than 1% on education. And what great Gulen was saying, that a nation is great in proportion to the advancement of education. The state governments, they hardly spend about 2.3%. And for decades, it has been demanded spend at least 6% on education. But that goal is still too far off. Now, quickly speaking, without going into further details, initially education was in the state list. And therefore, different states gave the different treatment, which I will demonstrate in a minute, as to the challenge to right to education, because it differs from state to state. Then you got it in the concurrent list, and somehow the center started taking the responsibility to some extent as well. And finally, in 2009, you got this law. Allow me to say this evening that in the history of lawmaking in India, it was for the first time that a law was enforced with a speech by the Prime Minister. Never in Indian history, Prime Minister said that from today, X law is going to be enforced. But when right to education was enforced from 1st of April 2010, the Prime Minister himself addressed the nation. And this is what he said. We are committed to ensuring that all children, irrespective of gender and social category, have access to education. An education that enables them to acquire the skills. Reference was made by Professor Reddy that MANUU may think of helping. In any case, they have polytechnics. An education that enables them to acquire the skills, knowledge, values and attitudes necessary to become responsible and active citizens of India. Now, this act has made education a fundamental right of every child from 6 to 40. The act lays down minimum norms in government schools. It requires the reservation of 25% of places in private schools for children from poor families, prohibits unrecognized schools from continuing, and makes provisions for no donation or capitation fees or no interview of the child or parent for admission. I was on the continent of Africa, in fact, advising the government on their law reform. And then I had to terminate my contract. Believe it, I had to terminate my contract. And I incurred huge financial loss for terminating that contract. And come back to India because my four-year-old daughter wanted admission in Lady Fatma in Aligarh. And therefore, I had to send back my wife and we had to prepare, you know. The four-year-old child was prepared for that interview. I had to fly to India to appear before an interview to get an admission. Now the act finally makes a very, very bold statement, no interview for admissions. The act provides that no child shall be held back, expelled, or required to pass a board examination until the completion of elementary education. There is a provision for special training of school dropouts, which is a huge problem, particularly in the Muslim localities, to bring them at par with the students of the same age, and the right to education of persons with disabilities until 18 years of age has also been included. The Act provides for the establishment of National Commission for Protection of Child Rights and a State Commission for Supervising Proper Implementation of Act, looking after complaints and protection of child rights. And a committee was set up to study the funds requirement, and the funding was estimated to be to the tune of 1.71 trillion rupees, which means about 38.2 billion. And the central government, for a change, I said that the education in India center has nothing to do with it. And from 76 till 2009 also, except for some small, you know, Sarv Shiksha Abhiyan and other things, hardly there was funding from the center. But under this law, the center is committed to provide 65% of funding. So it is a 65-35 ratio between center and state. And in the northeast, it is 90 to 10%. 90% funding for the seven sisters in northeast would come from the central government. Therefore, for the first time in India's history, the children are guaranteed their right to quality elementary education by the state with the help of families and communities. Now, with these few features, let us look at the issues. In a rights-based approach to education, founded on principles of universality and equity, there are inevitable tensions that arise in the process of implementation. And just about one provision, which has been too much in news, the Act said, blindly borrowing from United States, that day you remember, I said that in our wildlife laws, we blindly borrowed from Canadian experiment, thinking that human beings are danger to wildlife. So let them be thrown out of jungles. Our experience was different. Similarly now, borrowing from the neighborhood school concept of United States, we made a provision in India, a very welcome provision. But how it is working, I'll show you in a minute. That 25% seats are to be reserved in private institutions for the neighborhood children. So many poor children have been admitted in these schools. Now, what is happening to these children? This is a report from Bangalore. 8 children from the Lagari area of West Bangalore were admitted to Oxford English School under the 25% quota for poor children guaranteed by the Right to Education Act, but their joy was short-lived. There is a tale of trauma and neglect hidden behind these innocent faces. 3 children say that their classmate chopped off tufts of their hairs during class, but teachers did not bother to intervene. In fact, school officials exclude them from many activities. These children are made to sit in the last bench. They are not given homework. They have not been allowed to participate in class, like writing on the board, like other children's. Even when there was a test, these children were excluded from taking the test. They have not been given the school tie or a school diary, even though their parents repeatedly asked it. And what is the purpose? The purpose is that the school authorities want parents should voluntarily withdraw these children. Because the government has not made in the law it clear how they will be compensated. Okay, in terms of fee, maybe the government will pay the fee at the rates of government schools' fee. But there is a lacuna in law itself. I always believe that in our country somehow we feel law can bring about a social change. Law can never bring about a social change. You got the law, dowry prohibition law. It has not changed anything. In fact, the strongest and the greatest argument against the Uniform Civil Code is this. You change the Hindu law. It has not helped the Hindu women. Because normative changes in law do not bring about a change unless there is a behavioral and attitudinal change in the people through education. We have not educated the rich and elite of our country to contribute towards poor people. We have not yet incorporated the concept of corporate social responsibility. With our 1 or 2 initiatives from Reliance or Premji Foundation here and there, by and large, just because there is a compulsion of law, these students have been admitted. But if they are not integrated, if they are not treated in an equitable manner, I think we are causing a very severe damage to their psyche. And this kind of discrimination will permanently divide our society. And it is not a great thing to happen. Now, the other issue about which I would like to talk about is that this present UPA government, you know, allow me to say, it's a very, very good government. But to be good is one thing, but to be pragmatic is another. Madam Gandhi had constituted a National Advisory Council which has all leading, you know, NGO people there, N.C. Saxena, Harsh Mandar, this and that, John Dres. Now, these people are idealists. And therefore, number of provisions which you have made in this law, they can't be translated at once into reality. On the question of education, the framers of the Constitution were conscious of this fact. They did not include it straight away in the fundamental right. They put it in the directive principles so that when you have the capacity, when you have the resources, over the years you should do it. Similarly, here we have said, okay, there will be trained teachers, there will be this facility, that facility. Our schools are not ready for that. Creative and sustained initiatives are crucial to train more than 1 million new and untrained teachers in the next 5 years and to reinforce the skills of existing teachers to ensure child-friendly education. Bringing 8 million out-of-school children into classes at the age-appropriate level with the support to stay in a school and succeed poses a major challenge. They have made a provision. If a child is outside the school, he will be brought back to the school, will be given a class which is appropriate at his age level, will be given a special coaching, this and that. We are living, you know, in some dream world. This is not our real world. By making education for children between 6 and 14, we have ignored first 5 years. What happens in those first 5 years? What happens after 14? 14 is not enough to give you even class 10 degree, class 10 certificate. Therefore, both ends, we have not done justice. Children, that's why the preschool is equally important, and we need to extend it to 18, not 14. Then there is a problem about making of the rules from number of states, you know, you are not getting enough response. And I, as I said before, that it's in the state where this act is to be properly implemented. And unless the states rise up to the occasion, the central government won't be able to do it. Therefore, let me very quickly give you the state scenario. Karnataka already, even before this act, offered free education till class 10. One of the criticisms of right to food is this, that they now say each family will get 25 kg of, you know, food grains free of cost a month. Already there are states where there is a universal right to food and they give 35 kg. So the new right to food promises less than what already some states, Tamil Nadu and others, are doing. So Karnataka offers free education till class 10, but the Right to Education Act makes education a fundamental right, which is good, but the teacher-student ratio is bad and the state needs 1300 crores for next 3 years. Gujarat, you have an interesting scenario. Gujarat passed the Compulsory Primary Education Act way back in 1961, but it was never notified. You pass a law, you don't notify it, nothing happens. The 44th Amendment of the Constitution, humanizing the preventive detention, was passed in 78, has not been notified till date. The Industrial Dispute Act was amended and humanized and liberalized and made pro-labor in 1982, has not been notified yet. And there are laws, Advocates Act, some provisions were notified exactly 50 years after the act was passed. So you had an act in 1961, which was never notified. The state and center will have to spend in Gujarat 2,500 crore on salaries and another 1,000 crore on building 30,000 new school rooms. As per the act, this is the requirement for Gujarat. Whatever, you know, TV anchors and Congress Rajya Sabha members may say about the chief minister being the lion, a lion should have done all this. The state government will have to recruit 60,000 new teachers. This is the deficiency in Gujarat. And in Gujarat, there is another problem. The elementary education ends at class 7. Under the Right to Education Act, it would end at class 8. Therefore, there is a disparity. In Kerala, another state, education up to class 12 is already free. So what is so great in the new law? Just one more minute. So already education till class 12 is free, universal and compulsory since 1957, because they had the spell of communist rule. The minimum age of entry is 5. Under the new law, the minimum age of entry is 6. Therefore, there is a contradiction. And then the state has need some 1600 crores over 5 years. Rajasthan requires 1758 crores to build 43,510 rooms in primary and upper primary schools, provide electricity in 50,032 schools. They don't have electricity at the moment. As many as 57,000 schools don't have electricity. Construct boundary walls in 33,500 girls' toilets and in 2881 provide drinking water. Rajasthan needs another 1300 new teachers. Therefore, this is the dilemma. One more thing and I'll close. While it is true that a substantial number of students do not get education because there is no affordable school in the neighborhood, especially in the tribal hilly areas and sparsely populated desert districts, in a very large number of cases, education is not the first priority in our country. The priority is the survival of the family. Children working as rag pickers, shoeshine boys, domestic help, regular or contract or piece wage workers in several kind of factories and on farmlands are a regular phenomena all over India, especially in the poorer districts. To attract and retain children of these families in the school is not possible through compulsion of a law, that you got a law. Or is it a question of opening of schools in neighborhood? You open the schools. I will not go to the school because first of all, I must survive. If I survive, then I need education. The children of these families remain uneducated because of the mere accident of their birth in that families. They must not be allowed to suffer for no fault of theirs. They have the right to be educated, and therefore the state has to step in. It should be noted that though often the trade-off between the school and child labor has been underlined, the two activities need not be mutually exclusive. In a country like India, you can't say any child who is not in school is a child labor, abolish child labor, everybody must come to school. People need to survive. Therefore, don't make them mutually exclusive. You should examine the possibility of combining work and school by reducing the duration of school to just half a day or by changing the school timings. Special problems require special solutions. Schooling may be provided when the children are free from domestic duties or paid or unpaid work through night schools, mobile schools and the like. And this will involve no cultural break and no cost to the family. And NGOs can be involved in this. With these few lines, I'll close with this statement that this act, with whatever deficiencies, is still a welcome beginning. And if I look at the NAREGA and the health bill and the right to food proposed bill, at least the government is going in the right direction. Of course, you will have teething problems, but we need to help them. It is not the responsibility of the state alone. Ultimately, the people have to rise to the occasion. And if in our community in particular, we have some good, powerful NGO activity, the civil society activity, we would be able to educate every child. Thank you very much.